Thank you very much, and welcome to this evening's program. Happy St. Patrick's Day to all of you. What better way to celebrate St. Patrick's Day than with a concert of all Shostakovich string quartets? If you've been perusing your program booklet, you will know already that the Jerusalem Quartet has elected to present these quartets not in chronological order, but in four programs, each of which consists of early, middle, and late quartets. And this notion of early quartets as it applies to Dmitri Shostakovich is a bit misleading. Mozart wrote early quartets. His first quartet was composed in 1770 when he was all of 14 years old. Shostakovich's first quartet was written in May of 1938 when he was already a fully mature and battle-scarred composer of 31, with five complete symphonies to his credit. And those of you who were at my overview lecture this past Wednesday will know what I mean by battle-scarred. In 1936, in January, he was denounced and excoriated for the sins of formalism in his opera Lady Macbeth of Mtsensk, and he descended to the status of being an enemy of the people and clawed his way back about two seasons later in November of 1937 with his Fifth Symphony. Then he entered a fallow period. He was apparently quite exhausted by all of the tumult of the previous couple of seasons. And so he finally came back to life creatively in May of 38. Probably the precipitating factor was the birth of his second child, Maxime, on May the 10th, 1938. And about 2 weeks later, he began to write, mostly as an exercise, this first string quartet. And it is an utterly different piece than his Fifth Symphony. That is D minor, brooding, full of ambiguity and dualism. This piece is Haydn-esque. It is neoclassical. It is C major. He wrote it very quickly, sort of took on a life of its own. And after he had completed it, he said this about it. He said, "I visualized childhood scenes, somewhat naive and bright moods associated with spring," which is a good description of the piece because it is a product of a rather halcyon period in his life. The ideological pressure from above was off. His family life was burgeoning. And I think you can hear all of that in this warm, winsome first theme. It really is an adult looking back at his childhood, and you have this sense of entering into some childhood fairy tale forest, perhaps. And as we continue down that path, we come to a second character in this drama, a grinning cellist. One of the features of his string quartets that we will come in contact with over and over and over again is that nothing happens the same way twice. And so when we return at the end of this first movement to the recapitulation of that early theme, do, 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 si, do, re, do, si, la, so, fa, you'll notice that it has changed in an essential way, although it is still recognizably the same music. So you note it is familiar, and yet we've gone from three-quarter time to four-quarter time, which gives us this sense of homecoming, and yet something is different. Somebody has rearranged the furniture. Somebody has eaten our porridge or slept in our bed to keep up with this fairy tale metaphor. Another aspect of his quartets that you will hear over and over again is the presence of variations movements of various kinds. And in this first quartet, it is a standard theme in variations based on a very beautiful Russian, very soulful melody and rather simple variations. I'll play you this. It starts in the viola. I'll play you a little of the first variation. First variation. This is his first string quartet per se, but it's not the first piece he wrote for this combination of instruments. A couple of seasons before, just before his denunciation in Pravda, he had completed writing the film music for a film called The Girlfriends by Lev Arnstam. It's about a group of children growing up in pre-revolutionary Russia, starts in about 1914. And the whole film score is conducted, it is scored for string quartet, and you'll hear that very melody we just heard as the melody under the scoring of the credits as they scroll by at the beginning of the movie. And it continues with string quartet music.
Дяденька городовой, почему ворота закрыли?
Не велено никого со двора пускать. Ваши на треугольнике опять бастуют.
So perhaps this association with childhood urged him to interpolate this into the first string quartet. Another feature of the quartets you will notice is agitated scherzo movements. Often sinister, sometimes brutal. You will notice that in the eighth quartet and the third quartet and the 10th quartet. Here it is agitated, but certainly not brutal, maybe a bit furtive. He wrote this quartet and it was premiered by an outfit called the Glazunov Quartet. And he told them to play it muted and as fast as possible. Oops. I nudged the mouse. This is the trio. So it has this rather Mendelssohnian quality to it, very lighthearted. This trio here, this lum, bum, 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 always reminds me a little bit of the beginning of the Italian Serenade by Hugo Wolf. It's another conspicuously lighthearted piece by a composer with whom we do not generally associate lightheartedness. And the final movement is celebratory and also very good-humored. Again, I think reflecting this relatively halcyon time in his life, humor is a part of his musical language. We will hear it all the way through his quartets, although often humor of a dark cast, that is to say, sardonic, ironic, sarcastic. Here it seems unadulteratedly happy and celebratory. So hang on to that feeling of unadulterated happiness because it's the last time we will encounter it in the quartets of Shostakovich. Another aspect of the quartets that you will begin to become familiar with is this sense of theatricality, the sense that there is a drama going on, some implied subtext. His Quartets are very much related to his relationships with the people to whom they are dedicated, and often to people who are not mentioned, but who clearly played a role in inspiring him. This fifth quartet, written in 1952, is dedicated nominally to the Beethoven string quartet. And these gentlemen were very close to him. He knew them for almost 50 years. They premiered quartets 2 through 14. He wrote 15 for them as well, but unfortunately, the cellist Sergei Chirinsky died, and so it was given to another quartet. And quartets 11 through 14 are dedicated to these gentlemen individually. So they are almost like portraits in a sense. We will see that when we get to the 12th quartet at the end of this program. This quartet, however, has what I would consider to be a sub-dedicatee, and that is Galina Ustvolskaya. And she was a student of his. She was a very fine composer, and he was very smitten with her, both as a composer and as a woman. She studied with him in the 1940s at Leningrad Conservatory, and at one point he said to her, "It's not I who have influenced you, it's you who have influenced me." And that was not hyperbole. You will see in this quartet the use of a theme that she wrote in her 1949 trio for violin, clarinet, and piano. It becomes a ubiquitous presence in this quartet. As a woman, frankly, she seems to have been one of the great loves of his life. And even 22 years later, in 1974, he was still pining over her in some part of his soul, because he incorporates the same theme into the Michelangelo sonnets that he wrote the year before he died. This fifth quartet is full of contrast, and more than that, I would say conflict. It begins with 12 bars in which we have four different ideas jammed close to each other. We have rising violin patterns in thirds, rather urgent. They're interrupted by a jagged viola interjection. We have a little fragment of lyricism in the first violin, and then in about the 12th bar, we have this explosion of mechanistic activity in the viola and the cello. Very fierce music all of a sudden. And now. So you get this sense of conflict building, and yet the second theme is completely different. It is lilting, it is waltzing, it is warm and rather romantic. And this nostalgic, almost 19th century sounding music is a feature of this piece as well. As we go along with this waltz tune, it's relegated to the lower half of the quartet. We hear it in the viola and the cello. And in the upper half, the violins go into 2-4 against 3-4. So we have this polymetrical conflict. 1-2, 1-2, 1-2, 1-2, 3, 1-2, 3, 1-2, 3. And as this movement builds and finally comes to this climax, it reaches a screeching three forte climax. And at that point, we hear another theme, a theme we haven't been introduced to yet. I've outlined it in red, so you will notice it as it goes by. That, of course, is Galina's theme. In its original piano trio version, it sounds like this. Thank you. And this theme becomes a ubiquitous presence in this piece. It becomes an idée fixe, like the theme from Berlioz's Symphonie Fantastique. We hear it in many different guises. At the end of this movement, we hear it in a ruminative, dreamy setting way up in the stratospheric range of the first violin. And so we get this intuitive sense that whatever this drama is about, that she is a major player in it. She is the protagonist. Each of these movements is connected by a thread of sonority in the first violin, in the case of the first two movements, a high F in the first violin. But the second movement is quite different in its texture. It's desolate. It is this sense of smoke rising over some ravaged battlefield of the soul here. And yet, as I say, in this piece, nothing stays the same for long. And after a while, this frozen, desolate landscape warms up considerably. And we hear a lovely, sweet, again, rather 19th century loving melody. It has a kind of a pulsation, like a heartbeat in the cello. Romance fades and we get back to that austere, desolate landscape from the beginning of the piece. The third movement, it begins again with one of these held over high notes in the violin, and then we hear a yearning motive as it rises up and then falls back, rises up, falls back. And then we encounter yet another waltz, very romantic, very romantic. By this time, Shostakovich is a very experienced film composer, and it's hard not to hear this without a sort of cinematic flashback notion. It has this notion of romantic lovers meeting at a party, having a tete-a-tete, sharing a little waltz out on the veranda. But of course, things don't stay the same, and pain creeps back into this, and we hear that waltz continue, but in fragmented, dissonant form. And again, at the climax, we hear her theme come barreling back in. So you get the sense that he's just tormented by the very thought of her. And at the end of this piece, we hear another version of this, now in the viola, serenading style, like a dejected lover, accompanied by large guitar strumming. He turns the string quartet into a giant guitar. Thank you. And we get the sense of just this resigned lover strolling off. All of this infatuation with her took place during the time that he was still married to his first wife, Nina. It was a complicated relationship that he had with Nina, and we will talk about that when we get to the seventh quartet, which is dedicated to her. But the fact that he had these dalliances does not mean that he was not in love with Nina. And she died suddenly and tragically in 1954 of a stomach tumor, unexpected. And it was devastating to him, and he fell into another period of artistic exhaustion, which went on longer than that period before the first quartet. And it was finally broken in 1956 when he met a younger woman whose name was Margarita Kainova. She was 32, he was 50 at this time. And they got to know each other, and within a very short time, impulsively, he married her. She bore a superficial resemblance to his wife, Nina, but he tried to explain to his social circle, to his friend Flora Litvinova, who is a biologist, a friend of both him and Nina, what the attraction was here. He said, "Margarita is a kind woman, and I hope that she will be a good wife to me and a good mother to my children. I hope that you will remain, as before, a dear friend of the household." Well, this was hoping too much. She had a few strikes against her from the beginning. One was that she was a member of the Communist Party, which did not appeal to his social circle. And also, she was really from another world. She was not a part of this hyper-intellectual circle that he was a part of. She was not really a sophisticated musician. And Flora Litvinova made this statement about her. "At supper time, Madame came to sit with us at the table. She is terribly uninteresting." And there is something rather horse-like about her. "She tries terribly hard to please everybody, from the guests to the children, and to adopt the right tone. But goodness, how vapid and unpleasant she is, particularly after Nina." It's sad, you know, you look at this lovely young woman and he looks happy, you know, it's like they had met, he's hoping for the best. And yet this marriage just collapsed under its weight under a couple of years. This sixth quartet was written in 1956. During their honeymoon, they went to Kemerovo, which is a beautiful resort, as you can see, along the Finnish border. And this sixth quartet has a very enigmatic quality to it. On the surface, it begins happily. It seems to be full of, we'll call it, guarded optimism, perhaps for the future of this relationship, perhaps because that was the mood of the time. Stalin had died in 54. Nikita Khrushchev had taken over. It was a time of thaw. It was a time of liberalization. Everybody was hoping against hope that things would be okay. And this first theme has this sense of almost manic happiness. It's like somebody grinning a little bit too hard. It's like we're trying to get back into that Hansel and Gretel forest from the first quartet, but we're not quite making it. The second theme is gracious. It is ingratiating. It feels like bowing. It goes on like that. But pretty soon the pain starts to creep into this, and we hear these vertical lightning bolts of pain falling down on that poor, unassuming theme from the beginning. And this movement ends enigmatically. He makes a little winking cadence, very unusual, and he encodes into it in a sort of a vertical anagram his signature DSCH, D, Re, Mi, Do, Si, and it's written vertically. You'll see what I mean. This "that's all, folks" kind of quality to it. And it would be strange if he did it once, but he does it four times. Every single one of these movements begins with exactly that same, I mean, ends with exactly that same formula once he transposes it into another key. The next movement begins with another happy, with quotation marks around it, waltz. It, to me, sounds a little wooden, a little stiff. You know, the Tin Man is waltzing now. And as we progress through this movement, we come to a trio section which is very different. It's rather haunting, chromatic, slithery. It has this sense of skating on thin ice. A little eerie, ghostly about it. And the next movement, it's as if we fall through that ice and suddenly we are in this somber, melancholy world of Shostakovich. Very beautiful but lonely cello solo in B flat minor, dark key for a string quartet. And he uses this theme as the basis of a passacaglia. This is another form of theme and variations that we hear throughout the quartets. It's a Baroque form, so you hear this theme in the cello, then it is repeated and repeated and repeated, and over it you have variation episodes. I'll play you the theme in the cello and then the first of these variations, which is another one of these Russian-sounding viola melodies. Honeymoon music. As we go through passacaglias, we see them coming and going. Almost invariably, the passacaglia theme will come back in a later movement. There is a sense of, more and more in these pieces, a unified theory of form, and the last movements tend to be longer. They tend to be compendiums of what came earlier. This last movement begins with another waltz. Lovely, a little lonely, perhaps a portrait of Margarita. And you hear it just like a graceful dancer circumnavigating an empty stage. A bit Romeo and Juliet-ish about that. And as she goes along, then encounters a more menacing, threatening gang of finger-snapping toughs here. Jets of Kamarova. And as this goes along, that opening waltz is relegated to the upper violins, and we hear it in a very manic kind of a quality, and the music becomes more and more dissonant, and at the climax we hear the return of that somber, melancholy Passacaglia theme, now in canon between the cello and the viola. So what began in this guarded optimism at the beginning of the quartet is descending into pain and ambiguity, as this marriage did, and it was over soon. We jump ahead for this final quartet, the 12th, to 1968. Now Shostakovich is aging precipitously. At the age of 62, he has all kinds of physical ailments. He is having heart attacks. He is having neurological problems with his right hand that interfere with his ability to play the piano. Even holding a pencil to compose is difficult. And he understands that he's already entered the last chapter of his life. And with this realization, he decides to begin to change his emphasis. He doesn't want to write so many public pieces like his symphonies, because the symphonies are constantly under ideological scrutiny for political correctness. And he decides to spend more time writing string quartets, which allow him to fly under the ideological radar and to associate with his most trusted and close musical allies. And he had no more trusted allies than these four members of the Beethoven String Quartet, who have now gotten to be older themselves because they've been together for 40 years. In the middle 1960s, they began to have their first ever changes of personnel. Vadim Borisovsky, the violist, retired. And then in 65, there was a much more wrenching change of personnel. Vasily Shirinsky, he's on the far left, the second violinist, got up one morning, went outside of his dacha to chop a bit of wood, had a massive stroke, and was dead when he hit the ground. It was a devastating moment, of course, for the remaining members of the quartet, but for Shostakovich, too. They had known each other a long time. And he decided to dedicate his 11th string quartet to Vasily Shirinsky. And then, being a courteous man, equally disposed towards these remaining members of the quartet, he inaugurated what became known as the Quartet of Quartets, which is 11 through 14, each dedicated to a remaining member of the original quartet. And the 12th quartet, which is the last on this program, is dedicated to the first violinist, Dmitri Tsiganov. He was the public face of the quartet. He's the man who dealt most often with the press. He dealt most often with Shostakovich himself. He was a commanding individual, a stunning violinist, and his personality was supposed to be intense to the point of fanaticism. And there are elements of fanaticism in the writing of this piece. You'll hear it. It's a very intense piece. In the second movement, for instance, there is a bizarre cadenza, lasts for about a minute, for first violin, completely pizzicato, starts very quietly and builds to a finger-blistering climax. strange music. And he commented on this. He said, Shostakovich praised my playing in the funereal episode of the second movement in the lengthy violin pizzicato section where one seems to hear the tread of death itself. It was as if he had reached the very core of my musical nature. And from those comments, we glean a couple of things. One is that this element of portraiture is a feature of these quartets. And the other is that these late quartets really are largely about death. And he begins this 12th quartet. It is the 12th quartet. And so he starts it for the first time with a 12-tone serialist row. We hear all 12 notes of the chromatic scale played in the cello. Unusual way for him to begin a quartet, because the socialist realist doctrine about 12-tone music is that it is bourgeois, it is decadent, it is Western. And he has adhered to that notion throughout his life. He's even lent his name to publications with titles such as Dodecaphony Shatters Creativity. And yet here he is starting a quartet with a 12-tone row. And people wondered about that, and they said, Dmitrievich, what is that about? And he said, everything in good measure. If, let's say, a composer sets himself the obligatory task of writing 12-tone music, then he artificially limits his possibilities and his ideas. However, the use of elements from these complex systems is fully justified if it is dictated by the concept of the composition itself. And we see that immediately. We hear that 12-tone row, and then it settles on a D-flat, and we are suddenly in clearly D-flat major in this rather consoling section. Soon after that, we hear another 12-tone row come wafting through the texture, this in the violin, leading to a rather Schoenbergian waltz, the second theme. So we intuitively glean that these 12-tone rows are not the harmonic basis of the piece. They are more like colors in his palette. They are architectural markers. They delineate sections of the piece. And also, my personal notion is that they represent death. About this time, we begin to see 12-tone rows at the beginning of the 12th quartet, the 13th quartet, 14th symphony, which is all about death, 15th quartet has rows in it. They all seem to be associated with that. The second movement is much longer than the first. It's about 20 minutes long, and yet it's divided into three sections. And it begins with adamant, shivering trills and this very ardent, descending five-note cello theme. This gives way after about 8 minutes of this fierce, intense beginning to funereal, rather muted hymn-like section, which alternates in the upper three voices of the string quartet with very passionate soliloquies that sound like eulogies for the deceased, perhaps, in the cello. A feature of this quartet and of all of his late quartets is an absorption in sonority itself. If you know the Bartok quartets, he uses, particularly in the fourth quartet, every sound that you can draw out of a string quartet. Shostakovich becomes like that as well. We've already heard pizzicato, we've heard muted sonorities, we've heard full bowed sonorities. We also hear whiny, metallic, ugly ponticello up on the bridge. We hear even uglier sonorities produced quadruple stops, bowed and pizzicato. All of this anger, perhaps, with the notion of death, or perhaps the death of Sharinsky. And at the end of the piece, as I said, everything comes back. You have the rose, you've got the five-note slashing tune in the cello. You've got those consoling, oscillating patterns from the first movement, and it culminates in D flat major in a very big way. We have giant D flat major chords falling down on us over and over. Very triumphant conclusion, very satisfying, and very unusual for Shostakovich. You will discover as we go through these 15 quartets that 10 of them dribble out in despair. They have the designation morendo, which means dying away. And yet here we are ending in this huge D-flat major climax at the very end of the piece. We have this arc, this trajectory. We go from desiccated tone rose to life-affirming D-flat major. And I think that that really is the message of the piece. It moves towards life affirmation at this point. So anyway, that is my take on those four quartets. And I hope that you will enjoy the concert tonight, and you should run off so you can hear it.